Good afternoon, everyone. Myself Chitra Mangal. I have done my research work under the supervision of Dr. Ritu Jain from Hiroki, ICG University. The title is Dielectric Relaxation Studies of 4-bromoacetanilate in Dilute Solution of CCl4 at different temperatures in microwave region. Dielectric relaxation is at high frequency metal gets polarized with delayed dynamic response due to which time lag occurs between field and molecular polarization imposes an irreversible degradation of energy to heat. It is mostly significant at the microwave frequencies. Importance of dielectric relaxation studies are it is important to find the structure of molecules, their configuration, their shape and size. Different properties we can find with the help of dielectric relaxation studies. Different kind of interaction like intermolecular, intramolecular associations we can have. We can understand the solute-solvent interaction, dipole orientation, important hydrogen bonding, distribution of charges in polar liquids. The material on which I was investigating was 4-bromoacetanilate. Here is the chemical structure of it. It is used to measure the toxicity in some pharmaceutical products for pesticides or for animals. It is very soluble in hot water. It is soluble in chloroform, benzene, ethyl acetate. And it is moderately soluble in alcohol and cold water. There are some IPAC name, molecular formulas, molecular weight, and it occurs in white to beige crystalline solid. Experimental technique. I have measured the dielectric constant and dielectric logs in microwave region, and the method I was used was, there are lots of methods, but I have specially used Huston et al. Method, which is which gives the formula to calculate epsilon prime and double prime. Here lambda O is the wavelength of free space, lambda C is cutoff frequency, cutoff wavelength, lambda G is the wavelength in empty waveguide, lambda D, rho is the value of inverse voltage standing wave ratio in low loss substance. The figure which is mentioned below was actually with the help of which I have done my experimental works to measure epsilon prime and double prime. It is a X-band microwave bench. This is the value to find the static dielectric constant. I have measured the value of epsilon naught with the help of dipole meter. And the value of epsilon infinity, I have measured the values of it with the help of Abbe's refractometer. All these operators are in the ICG, this IS research lab. These are some mathematical formulas to measure all the values of epsilon prime, double prime, epsilon naught, epsilon infinity. Then I measure different relaxation times, tau 1, tau 2, tau naught. Tau 1 is referred for intermolecular, tau 2 is for intramolecular, and tau naught for overall, for average relaxation time. Dipole moment, I have also measured dipole moment with the help of Higgins's method. And also measured various thermodynamic parameters like del F epsilon, del H epsilon, del S epsilon. These all have measured for dielectric relaxation process. Similarly, for viscous flow process, I have measured del F neta, del H neta, and del S neta. I have prepared samples of 4-bromoacetanilate by dissolving their different moles in 1 mole of carbon tetrachloride. And I have done my experimental work for 5 different weight fractions of 4-bromoacetanilate at a fixed microwave frequency of 9.27 GHz at 4 different temperatures with the help of X-band microwave bench. These are the graphs of this is a graph of epsilon prime against weight fraction, and the results are showing that the value of epsilon prime is decreasing with temperature and increasing with weight fraction, and their decrease with temperature may be due to the internal friction and medium increases, which required more energy to overcome this internal mechanical friction, and due to which energy gets reduced and hence epsilon prime decreases. Similar results I have got for epsilon double prime, that it is also decreasing with temperature and increasing with the wave fraction due to the, it suggests that there is no change in the nature of rotating molecule of antibodies. Similar trend I will get for epsilon prime, sorry, epsilon infinity and epsilon naught. The slope values of all these four graphs will give the values of A prime, A double prime, A naught and A infinity, which will help to calculate the various relaxation time values which are mentioned here, tau naught, tau 1, tau 2 and mu. Here you can see that tau 1 and tau 2 are decreasing with temperature due to the increased size of dipole and molar volume. We can also notice here that the values of tau 2 are higher than tau 1, which confirms the presence of more than one relaxation process, that is both inter and intramolecular are present there, molecular rotation present there. And due to the higher values of tau T, we can also interpret that intramolecular rotation dominates over overall rotation of molecules. If we plot a graph between ln tau T and 1 by T for dilute solution, we find that there is a negative slope we will find, which suggests that the relaxation process can be treated as a rate process. The slope of the graph helps to find the values of delta H epsilon. This is the graph between ln beta and 1 by T for viscous flow process. Again, it is a negative slope, which will help to calculate the value of delta H epsilon. Ye title mein likha hai. Here we can see that del f epsilon, del f neta increasing with temperature. If we discuss about the result, we find that del f epsilon increasing with temperature, which suggests that viscosity of the solvent decreases, the thermal agitation increases and molecule require more energy to come out the excited state. We also found that del f neta is higher than del f epsilon. It suggests that viscous flow process has both rotational and translation motion of molecules. Dielectric relaxation process has only rotational motion of molecule. Viscous flow process involves greater interference from neighborhood than dielectric relaxation. Enthalpy of activation, both are different from each other. Different type of bonding and breaking of bonding with neighboring molecules. The ratio of del H epsilon and del H neta was 0.191, which is less than 0.45, which suggests that molecules of 4-bromoacetylate should show solid rotator phase and dipole rotation is possible even at freezing point. The change in entropy, that is del H epsilon, found negative, which shows the possibility of few more configuration in activated state. And it also suggests that activated states are more ordered and aligned, and existence of cooperative orientation of molecule present there.
Thank you. My simple observation is, when you make such a presentation and you say that it increases or decreases, with what? Right?
No, I mentioned with temperature or wave fraction.
When you want to show the variation with respect to temperature, the graph should be written as a function of x-axis as the temperature.
Okay.
And the dielectric parameter on the y-axis or whatever it is.
Okay.
Right? When you represent it in terms of fraction,
okay, sir,
then the graph should be fraction.
Okay.
So you are,
but the four different lines were for temperature and
then you should not talk about temperature.
Okay.
You know, what's the temperature? Is that really interesting?
What do you say?
Yeah.
What's it?
What is the infinity?
Epsilon infinity.
What is that?
That is static constant, dielectric constant at optical permittivity, optical frequency.
You also said at zero freezing point. So
freezing,
you go to 0 degrees Celsius.
What, sir, wo jo freezing point wala concept hai, wo ek रेफरेंस है किसी पेपर का जिसमें उन्होंने बोला है कि अगर रेशियो ऑफ डेल एच एप्सिलॉन डेल एच थीटा लेस देन 0.45 होता है देन इट मीन्स दैट वो फ्रीजिंग पॉइंट पे भी उसका जो मॉलिक्यूल्स हैं वो सॉलिड रोटेटर पे शो कर सकते हैं. सर ये वेरिएशन एप्सिलॉन इन्फिनिटी एंड एप्सिलॉन नॉट में है. अगर एप्सिलॉन प्राइम और डबल प्राइम कंसीडर करते हैं तो वहाँ ये नहीं होता, ऐसा चेंज नहीं होता, इतना नहीं है डिफरेंस.
Okay, any other questions, sir?
You had some objective in the mind that you have not worked on that?
What is your objective?
You mentioned that you wanted to see the toxicity or something you mentioned.
That was just the about the 4-bromoacetanilate okay.
Made of calcium. Okay. That was general state.
Yes. Thank you very much.
I would like to congratulate all of them. They have done good work and presented it in a briefly 5 to 7 minutes. So that's a commendable job. Manoj Polda, Neeraj Kuleri, until lunch and come back, I will take the session.
Dr. Kanupriya Sachdev is currently working as a professor of Department of Physics and Material Research Center at MNIT Jaipur. She has supervised a number of doctoral theses and have published more than 26 research papers. She is associated with various research projects as co-PI in organizations like DAE, BRNS, Indian-Taiwan S&T Cooperative Program and DRDO. She is also the principal investigator of the research project by IUAC. We are honored to have you with us, ma'am. I now request Dr. Nidhi Bhargav, convener of the conference, to accord a floral vessel along with a token of our appreciation to Dr. Kanupriya Sachdev. Thank you, ma'am. I now request Professor S.N. Joshi to take over the session's proceedings.
Hello, good afternoon to all of you. You see the situation now. Suna. We have to be very active. And unfortunately, we are quite late. 45 minutes. We had scheduled. It was supposed to start at 2:15. So we are starting almost at 3 o'clock. 40 minutes late. So for that I request both the speakers to contain their presentation in about 25 minutes. So we have another 5 minutes for discussion. So that we will be able to some extent we will be able to cope with the situation. With that I request Dr. Kanupriya Sachdev, Professor Department of Medicine, MNIT Jaipur. The topic is already mentioned here. So I request you. Thank you.
So good afternoon everyone. Thank you, sir. I thank the organizers, especially Dr. Nidhi, to give me an opportunity to be here among the participants of this conference, and I see that most of them are the students here. So I think it's a good idea to expose them some of the recent trends in materials, and that would also, you know, thoda unke dimag ki khidkiyan khulengi isse, and they will get ideas, they will be inspired to move forward in this field. So thank you. Really, it's a good effort. Now, I'm here to talk on tuning of electrical and optical properties of multilayer films and modification of these films using low energy ion implantations. But looking at the audience, I think it would be better if I confine myself to more to the why this field is important, what is the research which is going on, and what are we doing there. And I will also talk something about the Material Research Center, which is an instrumentation facility being set up at MNIT, and it's been running there for the last 6 years very successfully. And it is really acts as a place and a hub for material researchers and scientists to explore their problems. So I think before I start my technical presentation, let me talk about the center first. So the center was established 6 years back at MNIT, and the objective and the intention, as I just mentioned, was to create a place where the researchers and scientists working in materials could use these facilities, because most of these facilities which are there were not available earlier. And so they could use these facilities and use them for their research work. So the equipment which we have, unfortunately I don't have the PPT for that, so I'll just be speaking about these facilities. Most of the facilities which we have, they are the analytical equipments, and they are the highly sophisticated equipment which will be used to study the microstructure and different properties of these materials. So we have electron microscopes, and in this category we have the scanning electron microscope, and that is to a field emission scanning electron microscope and a transmission electron microscope. So I think students here would be very much knowing that what is the advantage of using an electron microscope compared over the optical microscope. So these electron microscopes, they help you to see the object, see the microstructure of the of your sample at a very high magnification and a very good resolution, and you can go to the nanometer level for that. Other than the electron microscopes, we have a thin film deposition facility, and in this thin film deposition facility we have the physical vapor deposition methods as well as the chemical ones. So we have the electron beam, then we have the RFDC sputtering unit and a thermal CVD. So these facilities, and this is the only laboratory in MRC which is completely indigenous, and these facilities can be used to deposit thin films of oxides and metals, coatings for different applications, as well as you can grow carbon materials using the thermal CVD, like carbon nanotube, graphene, etc., and their composites. Another useful laboratory is for the electrical property characterization, where we have the semiconductor device analyzer and the impedance analyzer to analyze the insulators and the semiconducting materials. We also have a Hall effect. Students of MSc physics would be knowing about the Hall effect, and you know that this is very useful for the electrical transport properties of semiconducting materials. And we also have spectrophotometers for the optical properties, like for the transmission, the UV visible, then the fluorescence and FTIR, and a dynamic mechanical analyzer to analyze the mechanical properties, and a TGA, DTA to analyze the thermal properties of the system. Then we have a Raman microscope and the XPS for more advanced and sophisticated analysis. So this is an essence of, there are much more, and for of course if there are chemistry students here, then we have NMR and mass spectrometer as well. So these are the various facilities which are available there, except one or two, all of them are working and in right condition. And it is open, it acts as an open facility for all researchers across the nation. So it's a pan-India facility, and you can go and use them. I think many of the students who are working for their PhD here must be going to this center and using it, and of course the faculty is very much aware of it. So this was to give an idea that there is a place where you can go and work, and this will very much facilitate your work. So now I switch on to my presentation, move on to my presentation, and my presentation is about a very important component of optoelectronic devices, which is called as a transparent conducting electrode. You all are familiar with these applications, which are, you can see the applications are given at the bottom. The solar cells, which is an energy conversion device, flat panel displays, LCDs, light emitting diodes, defrosting windows, smart windows in buildings, resisting switching memory, invisible security circuit, etc. There would be many much more applications. All these applications, they require one component, one essential component, which is called as the transparent conducting electrode. You know, the smartphone which you have in your hand, that works because of the transparent conducting electrode. So what is a transparent conducting electrode? It's an electrode which is transparent, so it allows the light to pass through, and it is highly conducting, okay, to perform that function. Traditionally, the first material which was used to be, which was used as a transparent conducting electrode was cadmium oxide. About more than 100 years ago, Bartiker discovered it, he fabricated it and saw that it gave you a property of transparency as well as high conductivity. So the parameters which make a material as a good transparent conductor, that this should be highly transparent. And when you say it is highly transparent, then most of the applications, not all, but most of the applications need them to be transparent in the visible region. Of course, for some other applications, you will have to go to the IR region as well. But in most of the applications, you need them to be highly transparent in the visible region. And the wavelength of the visible region gives that any material which is highly transparent in the visible region should be a wide band gap material. And when we say a wide band gap material, we mean that it should be more than 3 electron volts. Then only it will be a transparent, it will act as a transparent material for the visible region. Sir, you just give me an idea of 5 minutes before so that I can wind it up. Now, the next property is that it should be highly conductive. That means the resistivity is of the order of 10 power minus 4 ohm centimeter. It should have sufficient number of charge carriers and high mobility charge carriers. And because this transparent conducting electrode does not work on its own, it needs to be incorporated into some device. So that means there has to be a band alignment with the active layer, wherever you are using, in which application, and the roughness has to be controlled, otherwise there will not be a good match between the two layers. So these are the important criteria which are required for a material to be a good transparent conducting electrode. And because, as I told you, that cadmium oxide was the first material, and then it led to the fabrication of many more such oxides. So traditionally, sometimes instead of TCE, we just call it as a TCO, because most of them are oxides till now. Even the mostly used is the ITO, so that's again an oxide. So as I was talking, these are the traditional materials, the binary compounds, these are the single cation oxides having D10 cations. And if they are in the stoichiometric state, then they are insulators, because they are wide band gap materials, so they will be insulators. But in the non-stoichiometric state, which comes from either from the interstitial metal ions or from the oxygen vacancies in them, they become N-type degenerate semiconductors. And this is how we get a very good electron concentration, charge carrier concentration, and naturally a high electrical conductivity in these materials. At the same time, because they are a wide band gap material, so they will be transparent. So this is how these two almost contradictory properties are generated together in a material. In the history of development of these materials, the next step was when the scientists doped the oxides. So Sb was doped in SNO2, fluorine was doped in SNO2 to give you FTO, and tin doped in Al2O3, ITO is the most popular transparent conducting electrode used till now. Then it led to aluminium being doped in ZnO, gallium being doped in ZnO, and these were used as a transparent electrode for thin film solar cells. In 1990s, people started working on multi-component oxides. So they took combinations of binary compounds to form ternary compounds and also multi-component oxides which were composed of the combination of these ternary compounds. And then people started experimenting with the structures. So multi-layered structures were there which also gave us the properties comparable to that of the ITO. So the advantage was that tuning of electrical, optical, chemical and physical properties was done by altering the chemical compositions and their structures to design suitable TCO films for specialized applications. Now, why is it required to find an alternative of ITO? Because ITO was doing good enough, it is still going good enough. Then why people were searching for a transparent conducting electrode which is indium free? The reason was there were some certain drawbacks or certain disadvantages attached with ITO. The main component indium is, it comes along with mining of zinc and the availability is not much. So it's a scarce material. So that leads to the fluctuation in the cost of this material. Then, in order to get the properties, the resistivity of 10 power minus 4, transparency of greater than 80%, and energy band gap which is suitable, this has to be annealed after the synthesis. And this annealing temperature is in the range of 250 to 400 degrees centigrade, which is a necessity. And this is not suitable for when you want to deposit this ITO on a flexible material. You know that flexible or organic materials, organic electronics, it is the need of the day to day. People are moving it. Organic materials for every device, and this cannot be done on a flexible substrate if you want to anneal it afterwards. It also requires a higher thickness, which is about 300 nanometer, and moreover it is not giving very good mechanical properties. So the ductility is not there and the film is brittle, and if you subject it to some kind of mechanical bending or some kind of mechanical stress, then it breaks very easily and also develops cracks in it after some number of cycles. So that is again a big disadvantage for this type of, for the ITO. So all these factors led to the search of an indium-free transparent conducting electrode, and these were these are the different alternatives on which the researchers all over the world are working now. And looking at the need of the actually growing demand of a transparent conducting electrode with all the devices which I shared with you earlier, looking at the applications, it is actually a very big market, billions of dollar market for a transparent conducting electrode. So these are the different categories which have been tried or still being tried to make it as a replacement of ITO. These are the doped metal oxides, then metal embedded multilayers on which we are working, carbon materials, carbon nanotubes, graphenes and their composites, conducting polymers, thin metallic films, because a metallic film when it is very thin, it becomes transparent, metallic nanowires and metallic grids. So these are the different categories on which the people are working. What we have developed in our lab in the last 6 years is that we have been able to produce a multi-layer TCO which gives comparable properties to that of ITO, and in terms of electrical and optical, so we call it EO properties, and it is having better mechanical properties compared to ITO, and moreover it is deposited at room temperature, so that high temperature problem is also addressed here. So the multi-layer TCO on which we work, it comprises of a TCO material which is deposited on glass substrate, and then a very thin metallic layer, and again the TCO substrate on the top. So we have a very thin metallic layer embedded between two TCO materials. Let me explain how the electrical and the optical properties work for this multilayer. In this, you can see that this is a schematic representation of the electrical behavior of this multilayer structure. And the three layers are parallel to each other. And the resultant resistance of this multilayer is given by this expression. Considering a typical case, because the resistance of the metal is much higher than that of the, resistance of the TCO is much higher than that of the metal, so the effective resistance of this combination comes out to be that of the metal. And because silver, we usually use silver in this, people are using gold and copper also, so all they are very good conductors, and this is how the effective resistance of this multilayer comes out to be that of the metal itself, giving us a very good electrical conductivity. So this coplanar configuration gives you the overall sheet resistance. The optical properties of the multilayer, it is controlled by, because what we need very good transparency, more than 80%. So that means the destructive interference has to be controlled, and this destructive interference is controlled in the beams reflected from the three layers, and what you get is the more than 80% light coming out of this multilayer. So I hope you understand transparency. The amount of light coming in and the amount of light going out, the ratio of the two will give you, considering the other reflection not being there. So considering that, the two, you will get the transparency of the multilayer structure. So because these are the three layers, and there is an interference between the three layers, and that is why the thickness of the films is important. Okay, so we have to optimize that what is the required thickness of the two TCO layers, which gives you the maximum transparency. One more important property parameter of the multilayers is the work function, and it has been observed that high work function of this multilayer, when it is used in a solar cell, it leads to higher efficiency, higher OCP, full circuit voltage, and large photo-generated current in the cell. So I'll skip this. So I'll give you one case study which we have done. This is a published work. So what we had taken is, we had taken a multilayer structure comprising of TiO2, the upper and the bottom TCO layer, with a thin silver layer in between. And we optimize the thickness of this structure for maximum transparency and maximum electrical conductivity. And this thickness actually we varied it from 25 to 65, and the optimized thickness, I think I have given it, yes. It's not written here, but it came out to be 45 nanometers. The optimized thickness of this multilayer. So, what we found is that if the TiO2 layer was thinner than 45 nanometers, the transparency was low. If it was more than that, again the transparency was low. In the first case, it was of strong reflection because the silver layer was more dominant. And in the other case, if it is thicker, then it absorbs more light intensity. So again, the transmittance is less. So the optimized thickness of 45 nanometer gave us the highest transparency. These are the four different thickness. And what we did was, we calculate the figure of merit for this film. The figure of merit is given by HAC, and this figure of merit is P to the power 10 divided by the sheet resistance. Okay? So this was the highest figure of merit obtained by, yes, it's written here, obtained for this structure, 45, 9, 45. Now how do we optimize this 9 nanometer? Because the silver layer has to be as thin as possible, but again the problem is that if it is less, if it's lesser than this, then it doesn't show up as a continuous layer. So you will have islands, because it's an island growth. So we have islands of sputtered silver there, which do not connect with each other, and the conductivity doesn't come. So the silver layer, the minimum layer which becomes continuous, and we found it for our system to be 9 nanometer. People also have reported it between 8 to 10 nanometer. And this is the main condition for the thickness of the silver layer. So what we did was, then we took this optimized thickness layer and then we did some ion implantation to modify the properties. When we said modify, we wanted to improve upon the electrical and the optical properties of this. And let me give you an idea of what ion implantation is. We have ions of different ions which have been accelerated to certain energy. And then they are bombarded on your sample. And when they go into the material, they lose their energy there and get implanted there. And in this process, they can modify the structure and the properties of that material. So this was the process which was used in these multilayers. And we used a nitrogen ion which was implanted in these multilayers. And the stopping range of these ions was such that they got embedded in the multilayer structure. Why nitrogen ion was chosen? Because of it had an atomic radii which was comparable to that of oxygen, because it had to go in the TiO2 crystal structure. So it had a radius comparable to that, and when it substituted the oxygen site, it led to creation of new electronic states just above the valence band edge of the TiO2. So these new electronic states just above the valence band of TiO2, that led to band gap narrowing, and in the process improved upon the electrical properties of the system. So these are the study results after we have used different fluents of the ions, and this is just some RBS measurements to find out the thickness of our multilayers. And what we, I'll just get you to the result. I think I should skip all the XPS and all these things. I should get the conclusion. So this is the summary. What happened on implantation? The replacement of oxygen ions by the nitrogen ions resulted in band gap narrowing and improved the electrical conduction. This was also corroborated by the XPS, where we could see a shift in the TI to PP, because the TI earlier was bonding to oxygen and now to nitrogen. The surface also, of course, there was a change in the surface roughness with the fluence, and there was a simultaneous degradation in the optical properties from 80% to 70% because of the presence of defects in the multilayer. But the important expression which decides the performance of these multilayer films is the Hack figure of merit, and in the Hack figure of merit we could see that this slight degradation of optical transmittance was not of much disadvantage to these films, and we could get a very high figure of merit. So there was a very good improvement in the electrical properties of these multilayer structures, one order you can see, and that led to increase in the figure of merit from 5.2 to 5.7 in these figures. And of course, a very small I'm just looking for the sheet resistance. I've given the formula. The sheet resistance of these films is again very important, and you need a sheet resistance of less than 10 for the photovoltaic applications, and we could get a sheet resistance very close to that. This is given by the resistivity divided by the film thickness. So a very good sheet resistance was obtained for these multilayer films. So I think I can conclude there, because the time must be over. So I will curtail my lecture. There's one more case study, and I would like to, of course, this work is a work of my PhD student who has just submitted his PhD and actually defended 2 days back only. So I'm thankful to him for doing this work, and I'm thankful to IUAC for giving us the beam time for the low energy ion implantation, and of course the Material Research Center for the facilities. So any questions?
Any questions? Otherwise, let us thank Dr. Kanpia for his estimate, and we apologize on behalf of the organization for urging the time.
No, it's okay, but I would be happy if there is even a small question from the students. That shows that they have learned something, or you know, understood something. I think they are very
well.
So डरने की जरूरत नहीं है, सवाल सही गलत कुछ नहीं होता है ना, और यहाँ कोई जज करने वाला नहीं है आपको. So I hope you enjoyed the lecture. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we have the next one now from Professor Vinay Vijay. He is very interesting. He has brought for demonstration. He is talking about importance of light for life. Photonic and other effects with demonstrations.
आप लोग थोड़ा आगे आ जाएं तो ज़्यादा अच्छा
रहेगा. And I know जो भी चीज़ मैं बताऊँगा आप सबको
पता
है. आपको खाली recollect करना है. What I'm saying, you know it. ओके जो थीम लिया है लेकर लाइट फॉर लाइफ
इसमें वो है क्या
रिमोट आई डी जी स्विच दिस लाइट डेमोन्स्ट्रेशन ओके देखिए मजेदार मजेदार चित्र हैं फोटो है पहले फोटोज दिखा दूं ठीक है एपरेटस भी है एपरेटस भी चलते हैं तो चला के दिखा सकते हैं और यदि इनकी वीडियो देखनी है तो वीडियो भी देख सकते हैं और सर ने तो सरप्राइज किया कि मैंने इस तरह के बहुत सारे खिलौने कई देखे हैं देन ही रिकलेक्टेड वीडियो में देखे हैं ठीक है तो यदि आपको और ऐसे खिलौने देखने हैं You are most welcome to Vivekananda Global University. ये जगत पुराना है, it's a beautiful picture, ठीक है? ये रिव्यू है, ये पूरा यूनिवर्सिटी कैंपस है,
हम अंदर बैठते हैं और इस कोने में विजयू है, इनोवेशन हब, सॉरी इनोवेशन हब, क्योंकि ये जो भी इनोवेटिव आइडियाज होते हैं उनको हम शेप देते हैं और फिर रख लेते हैं अपने पास. एंड खुद को अच्छा लगता है इसलिए हम दूसरों को बताते हैं, ठीक है ना, कि हमारे पास अच्छी चीज है. ओके, एक अच्छी चीज है, देखो लेजर लाइट, ठीक है, बहुत ब्राइट लाइट, अच्छी लगती है. दिस इज मोनोक्रोमेटिक लाइट, है रास्ता भी दिख रहा है इसका नजदीक से देखेंगे तो, बिकॉज ऑफ द किंडल इफेक्ट. ठीक है, ये छोटे छोटे डस्ट पार्टिकल हैं यहां, उन डस्ट पार्टिकल से फोटोन स्कैटर हो रहे. ओके, और ये जो भी फोटोन है, बिकॉज आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट, थोड़ा पीछे कर दो टाइटल, हाँ चलो इधर ही रखो, हाँ और पीछे लाइफ फॉर लाइफ. ओके, दिस इज द टाइटल, हमारी लाइफ के लिए लाइट क्यों जरूरी है. तो पहले तो लाइट समझना है, लाइट क्या है. ओके, लाइट इज द लाइट, जैसे ये ट्यूबलाइट लगी हुई है उसी को लाइट बोलते हैं. दीज आर नथिंग बट फोटोन्स, बीम ऑफ फोटोन्स, तो ये भी एक लाइट का सोर्स है. ओके, ये मोनोक्रोमेटिक लाइट है, बिकॉज ऑल फोटोन्स आर हैविंग सेम एनर्जी, ठीक है ना. बट सनलाइट इज अ वाइट लाइट विच हैज गॉट मेनी कलर्स. ओके, सो दिस इज वॉट वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड, ठीक है. एंड फोटोनिक्स क्या है, फोटोनिक्स इज इंटरेक्शन ऑफ लाइट विथ इलेक्ट्रॉन. ओके, अब इलेक्ट्रॉन कहां है, इलेक्ट्रॉन हवा में तो होते नहीं है, इलेक्ट्रॉन हर एक मटीरियल में होते हैं. मटीरियल इज मेड ऑफ एटम्स और मॉलिक्यूल्स, और एटम्स एंड मॉलिक्यूल्स में न्यूक्लियस होती है और न्यूक्लियस के आसपास इलेक्ट्रॉन्स होते हैं, एंड दे आर इन डिफरेंट एनर्जी लेवल्स. ओके, ठीक है, ऊपर ही ऊपर जो है वो ऑलमोस्ट फ्री होते हैं, मेटल्स में फ्री इलेक्ट्रॉन होते हैं, ठीक है ना, उनको गर्म करो उसमें से निकल जाते हैं. ओके, दैट इज कॉल्ड थर्मो आयनाइजेशन, ठीक है ना, मेटल का आयनाइजेशन कर सकते हैं अपन, इलेक्ट्रॉन निकाल सकते हैं, तो मेटल सरफेस पॉजिटिवली हो जाएगी, ठीक है ना, क्योंकि ओवरऑल न्यूट्रल है, एवरीथिंग इज न्यूट्रल. ओके, सो वी विल टॉक अबाउट दैट फोटोनिक्स. जो इंटरेस्टिंग चीज बता रहा था बीच बीच में बता दूंगा, ये मजेदार है. ओके, तो ये एक बीम फोटोन की निकल रही है, ठीक है ना, बट यहां कुछ लगाया रास्ते में और उससे क्या हुआ, काफी सारी बीम हो गई, ठीक है ना, और काफी सारी बीम हो गई मीन्स दे आर स्कैटर्ड, द फोटोन्स, ऑल द फोटोन्स विच वर गोइंग स्ट्रेट दे आर नाउ स्कैटर्ड, एंड स्कैटर्ड में वी कैन मूव देम ऑल्सो. थोड़ा सा टाइट हो जाए फिर पता लगेगा. ओके, दे कैन बी मूव. ओके, बहुत बढ़िया, क्यूबिक लैटिस बन गए, ठीक है ना. इस तरह के पिक्चर्स इलेक्ट्रॉन डिफ्रैक्शन के, क्रिस्टल सिमेट्री के सर ने दिखाया नैनो मटीरियल में, ठीक है ना, बट ये आपको हाथ से दिखते हैं, कुछ नहीं है, कुछ भी नहीं गड़बड़, एक जाली लगी हुई है और दूसरी जाली लगी हुई है, तो जाली में से जब लाइट जाती है तो वो फैल जाती है, डिफ्रैक्ट हो जाती है, तो दैट्स ऑप्टिकल डिफ्रैक्शन. ओके, सो व्हाट आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट, कि लाइट किसी ऑब्जेक्ट से टकराती है तो क्या होता है, ठीक है ना, लाइट इज अ फोटोन, ठीक है ना, सन से आ रही है तो क्या हुआ, पृथ्वी के ऊपर सूरज की रोशनी आई तो पृथ्वी पे भगवान बैठे होंगे, तो उनको जगाया कि भैया कुछ करो, ठीक है, तो जनरेशन, ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एंड डिस्ट्रक्शन, तो कुछ जगाओ लोगों को, कुछ करो, पेड़ पौधे उगाओ, ठीक है ना, दैट्स हाउ द सृष्टि बिकेम इन एग्जिस्टेंस. दैट इज व्हाट वी थिंक, कि हम सब कहां से आए, भगवान के यहां से आए, दिस इज व्हाट वी थिंक, बट साइंटिफिकली देर इज समथिंग बियॉन्ड. ओके, कि हमारी लाइफ साइकिल जो शुरू हुआ वो बिलियन साल लगे, ठीक है ना। धूप से कुछ न कुछ यहां गड़बड़ हुई होगी, पानी में अमीबा वगैरह जानवर पैदा हुए स्मॉल, ऑलराइट, एंड देन कुछ न कुछ और डायनेमिक्स हुई, कुछ और फोटोकेमिकल रिएक्शन हुए, ऑलराइट, एंड प्लांट्स वगैरह ग्रो होने लगे, ठीक है। एंड दैट्स हाउ द फोटोसिंथेसिस स्टार्टेड। एंड कोई फूड भी प्रोड्यूस हुआ तो कुछ हर्बीवोरस और कार्निवोरस जो डिफरेंट तरह के एनिमल्स हुए, एंड उसके बाद ह्यूमन सोसाइटी जो सिविलाइजेशन है वो खाली 100 ईयर्स की है। दैट इज व्हाट वी नो। न्यूटन, आइंस्टाइन, रमन, इस तरह के साइंटिस्ट कब हुए थे? 1900 के आसपास हुए, उससे पहले की कोई कहानी वी डोंट टॉक अबाउट। सो अवर मॉडर्न डे साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी, राइट, नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी तो अभी ज्यादा पुरानी नहीं है, 1980 से शुरू हुई है जब डीएनए का मॉलिक्यूल का स्ट्रक्चर देखा गया, उसकी साइज मेजर की गई, ठीक है ना। फिर जब कार्बन नैनो ट्यूब बनी या बकीबॉल लोगों ने आइडेंटिफाई की, आजकल अब ग्रेफीन की बात करते हैं, मोनोलेयर, ओके। तो ये तो रियली रीसेंट टाइम 2000 के बाद की चीज है। बट इससे पहले, सबसे पहले व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट सी वी रामन, 1930 की बात है। बट इनके साथ साथ ही एक और कोई यूनिक चीज है, एकदम जंप कर जाती है। आई लाइक टू टॉक अबाउट द थ्री इंडियन साइंटिस्ट कंट्रीब्यूशन, ठीक है ना। रमन का नाम जानते हैं, रमन इफेक्ट। आई विल शो यू व्हाट इज अ रमन इफेक्ट यूजिंग अ मैकेनिकल मॉडल। ये रिसेंट क्रिएशन है, रिसेंट खिलौना है, इसलिए हमें अच्छा लगता है लेके आए, ओके। यही रिपीट हो रहा है
सर, कर देंगे आप।
तीन साइंटिस्ट के नाम बताइए, उनको क्वांटम इंडियन फिजिसिस्ट बोलते हैं, ठीक है। सबसे पहले मेघनाथ शाह का नाम जाना जाता है। मेघनाथ शाह डिस्क्राइब्ड अबाउट हाउ द लाइट इज ओरिजिनेटेड फ्रॉम सन, ओके। तो दिस इज कॉल्ड शाह इक्वेशन, एंड ही एक्सप्लेन दैट सन के ऊपर थर्मल आयनाइजेशन की वजह से लाइट प्रोड्यूस होती है, एंड दैट लाइट कम्स एंड ट्रेवल्स इन 8 मिनट एंड रीचेज ऑन मदर अर्थ, ओके। और पीछे नहीं है इसमें, कहां गड़बड़ है? तीन साइंटिस्ट के नाम, मेघनाथ शाह, हाँ, एस एन बोस का नाम इसलिए जाना जाता है, ही टॉक्ड अबाउट द स्टेटिस्टिक्स, द एनर्जी डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन बिटवीन एटम्स एंड मॉलिक्यूल्स, एंड एनर्जी एक्सचेंज के लिए जो फंडामेंटल पार्टिकल फोटोन की व्याख्या थी, ओके। एक पार्टिकल दूसरे पार्टिकल से कैसे इंटरेक्ट करता है, ठीक है ना, कभी पास नहीं आते, नो एनी पार्टिकल टचेस ईच अदर, क्यों? बिकॉज ऑफ द वैन डेर वाल्स फोर्सेस, बिकॉज ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक इंटरेक्शन, राइट। इवन इन सॉलिड द एटम्स आर नॉट टचिंग, ये एक मिसलीडिंग है, क्योंकि रदरफोर्ड ने सबसे पहले बता दिया था कि इवन गोल्ड फॉइल में से अल्फा पार्टिकल डालो तो वो निकल जाते हैं आर पार, मिस खाली खाली जगह है एटम्स के बीच में, जो बीच में इलेक्ट्रॉन क्लाउड है, राइट। तो दैट वॉज द वेरी ओल्ड हिस्टोरिकल डेवलपमेंट कि न्यूक्लियस साइज पता लगा, एंड इलेक्ट्रॉन क्लाउड और न्यूक्लियस साइज के बीच में ट्रांसफर 5 का डिफरेंस है, ओके। इट्स ए लॉन्ग डिस्टेंस, बिकॉज न्यूक्लियस साइज ऑफ द ऑर्डर ऑफ फर्मी होती है, ट्रांसफर -15 मीटर, और एटॉमिक साइज ऑफ द ऑर्डर ऑफ आर्मस्ट्रॉन्ग होता है, ट्रांसफर -10 मीटर। तो ट्रांसफर -10 और ट्रांसफर -15 में ट्रांसफर 5 का फर्क है, मतलब इतनी जगह खाली है,
ओके। एप्पल रख दो, अर्थ के सेंटर पे करीब करीब एप्पल रख दो,
एप्पल रख दो, दैट्स द रिलेटिव डायमेंशन, द साइज ऑफ द न्यूक्लियस इज सो स्मॉल, एंड जब सॉलिड भी बन जाता है, ठीक है ना, तो एक न्यूक्लियस दूसरे न्यूक्लियस से ट्रांसफर 5 टाइम्स दूर बैठी रहती है, ओके, एंड दैट्स द एम्प्टी स्पेस, एंड उसमें इलेक्ट्रॉन क्लाउड रहते हैं, ठीक है ना, जो आपस में इंटरैक्ट करते हैं। सो व्हाट आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट द हिस्टोरिकल डेवलपमेंट, रमन ने कहा कि फोटोन किसी भी मटेरियल पर गिरते हैं तो इलेक्ट्रॉन से ही दोस्ती करते हैं, इलेक्ट्रॉन से ही बात करते हैं, ओके okay? या तो इलेक्ट्रॉन से एनर्जी लेते हैं या इलेक्ट्रॉन को एनर्जी देते हैं. तो इलेक्ट्रॉन को यदि एनर्जी देते हैं तो दैट इज कॉल्ड फोटो इलेक्ट्रिक इफेक्ट. ओके जो कि आइंस्टाइन ने व्याख्या की, उसको नोबेल प्राइज मिल गया, ठीक है. बट न्यूटन तो देखता रह गया कि मैंने समझाया था ये बात, तो आइंस्टाइन उसको एक्नोलेज करता है रमन को, ठीक है ना, कि यार तुम सही कहते हो, ठीक है. बट कभी कभी क्या होता है कि एटम यदि एक्साइटेड स्टेट में हो तो फोटोन एनर्जी लेके चला जाता है. एंड दैट वाज द फर्स्ट ऑब्जर्वेशन बाय रमन कि एक स्ट्रोक लाइन भी देखी गई. नॉर्मली मोनोक्रोमेटिक लाइन में यदि रेड शिफ्ट हो जाती है, फोटोन की एनर्जी कम हो जाती है, इसको हम रेड शिफ्ट बोलते हैं, और फोटोन की एनर्जी बढ़ गई तो वो ब्लू शिफ्ट है. ओके सो दैट ब्लू शिफ्ट इज कॉल्ड स्ट्रोक लाइन. ओके ये फिनोमिना यदि लेबोरेटरी में देखना है तो कैसे देखें, ठीक है. रमन के पास कोई स्पेक्ट्रोमीटर होगा सेंसिटिव तो वो देख पाया, बट हमारे पास ऐसा कोई चीज नहीं है, ठीक है ना, टू जस्टिफाई यू. एक चीज है, हम फिजिक्स ठीक से जानते हैं. क्या फिजिक्स ठीक से जानते हैं कि कोई भी ऑसिलेटर है इट इज एज गुड एज फोटोन एच न्यू. जैसे मेरी मोनो एनर्जेटिक बीम है, ओके इन इससे जितने भी फोटोन निकल रहे हैं उन सबकी एनर्जी बराबर है एच न्यू. न्यू इज द फ्रीक्वेंसी, ठीक है ना. ये 530 नैनोमीटर का है तो इसकी फ्रीक्वेंसी एक 10^14 हर्ट्स है सम फैक्टर इनटू, तो ये इतनी है सबकी, ठीक है ना. एक मेरा बार पेंडुलम है तो इसकी फ्रीक्वेंसी कॉन्स्टेंट है व्हाट एवर इज द मास डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन. ओके इसका टाइम पीरियड है 1.5 सेकेंड, तो इससे मैं फ्रीक्वेंसी निकालू कि मेरी 0.75 आ रही है, तो दैट इज माई फ्रीक्वेंसी. ओके इट्स नॉट चेंजिंग, ठीक है. लेकिन इसको रोकना पड़ेगा, ठीक है. ये कुछ गड़बड़ कर रहा है नीचे. कैन यू सी इट या और ऊपर रखूं इसको? ऊपर रखूं. यदि इस नीचे वाले को पकड़ के रख लें तो ये पेंडुलम मजे से चलता है. ओके लेकिन इसको यदि छोड़ दिया जाए तो ये कभी कभी उससे एनर्जी लेता है, कभी कभी देता है. डिपेंड्स अपॉन द फेज. व्हाट इज द फेज? कि ये पेंडुलम किधर से आ रहा है और ये पेंडुलम किस तरह से ऑसिलेट कर रहा है, ठीक है ना. यदि इधर ऑसिलेट कर रहा है, उधर से पेंडुलम आ रहा है, तो इट विल गिव ए स्टॉप. ओके और यदि ये यू चल रहा है और पेंडुलम भी यू आ रहा है, तो इट विल जस्ट मूव स्मूथली. ओके और ये प्रोसेस हमने इंट्रोड्यूस किया यूजिंग मैग्नेट. ओके पेंडुलम पे भी एक मैग्नेट लगा रखा है, नीचे भी एक मैग्नेट है, सो देयर इज ए स्टॉक. ओके गिवन. ओके डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द फेज एंड इट्स एनालॉगस टू द रमन हाइपोथेसिस. ओके एटम यदि एक्साइटेड स्टेट में है, वो एक डायग्राम नेक्स्ट आप देखेंगे समझ में आएगा. ये तो डिफरेंट लाइट सोर्सेज हैं, दिस लेजर टोर्च और एलईडी लाइट. एलईडी लाइट और लेजर टोर्च में क्या फर्क है? जो ऑर्डनरी एलईडी लाइट है उसमें एक रेंज ऑफ फ्रीक्वेंसी मिलती है, ठीक है ना. ऑलराइट बट लेजर डायोड के अंदर मोस्ट ऑफ द फोटॉन्स आर हैविंग द सेम फ्रीक्वेंसी. ओके एंड इट्स अ कोहेरेंट लाइट सोर्स. एंड एक बीम है, एक डायरेक्शन में एलईडी की लाइट सब डायरेक्शन में जाती है. आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट द कैंडल आल्सो. कैंडल भी एक लाइट सोर्स है और ये कैसे है, कोई फ्यूल बर्न होता है, ठीक है ना. हाइड्रोकार्बन ऑक्सीजन के साथ मिलकर एटम्स एक्साइटेड स्टेट में आते हैं, ठीक है ना. अब जो एक्साइटेड स्टेट में एटम होते हैं तो वो नॉर्मली एनर्जी लेते हैं तो एक्साइटेड स्टेट में जाते हैं, लेकिन जब ग्राउंड स्टेट में आते हैं तो दे एमिट एनर्जी, दे लिबरेट एनर्जी. ओके सो दैट सॉर्ट ऑफ प्रोसेस हैपन्स एवरीवेयर. यहां पर हीट से एक्साइटेशन होता है, थर्मल एक्साइटेशन. ओके जब ग्राउंड स्टेट में आते हैं तो दे लिबरेट लाइट एंड दैट इज व्हाट वी आर गेटिंग एज अ सनलाइट. ओके एंड द सेम हैपन्स इन जुगनू. वो बायोलॉजिकल एक्साइटेशन है उसका, जब वो डीएक्साइट होता है तो लाइट देता है, पल्सेस देता है. ओके, इन फायर आल्सो और इन नॉर्मली लैंप आल्सो, नॉर्मल लैंप टंगस्टन फिलामेंट में एटम्स एंड मॉलिक्यूल एजिटेट होते हैं, टंगस्टन के फॉर एग्जांपल, एंड बेसिकली द इलेक्ट्रॉन एजिटेट होते हैं, और वो जब एक एनर्जी लेवल से दूसरे एनर्जी लेवल में जाते हैं देन दे एमिट द लाइट. ओके, सो कैन आई हैव द नेक्स्ट? या वेल, यहां देखिए साइंस ऑफ फ्लेम, ये मोमबत्ती है और इसको दो प्लेट के बीच में रखा, ठीक है, एंड दो प्लेट में बीच में रखा और यहां पर हाई वोल्टेज लगाया इन दोनों प्लेट के ऊपर. वी वांट टू सी कि ये जो फ्लेम है ये चार्ज है कि न्यूट्रल है. ओके, एंड द एक्सपेरिमेंट शोज दैट ये जो टर्मिनल है ना, रेड टर्मिनल ब्लैक टर्मिनल, तो रेड टर्मिनल इज फॉर पॉजिटिव एंड ब्लैक टर्मिनल इज फॉर नेगेटिव. ओके, तो कैन यू आइडेंटिफाई नाउ, ये जीरो फील्ड है, कोई डिफ्लेक्शन नहीं आ रहा इसमें, ठीक है ना, तो मोमबत्ती की फ्लेम सीधी जा रही है इन प्लेट के ऊपर. यदि आप इधर देखेंगे तो ये नेगेटिव की तरफ झुकी हुई है और यहां नेगेटिव टर्मिनल इधर कर दिया, पॉजिटिव यहां कर दिया, ये देखो ये पॉजिटिव यहां है, नेगेटिव यहां. ओके, तो कैन यू सी द डिफरेंस फॉर द सेम वोल्टेज? कैन यू आइडेंटिफाई नाउ कि फ्लेम पॉजिटिवली चार्ज है कि नेगेटिवली चार्ज है? पॉजिटिवली चार्ज, बिकॉज ग्राउंड की तरफ झुकती है. व्हाई? बिकॉज फ्लेम के अंदर एटम्स या मॉलिक्यूल एक्साइटेड स्टेट में है, देर आर आयंस एज वेल एज इलेक्ट्रॉन्स. इलेक्ट्रॉन क्विकली ड्रिफ्ट हो जाते हैं टुवर्ड्स मेटल प्लेट, बट जो वो डीएक्साइडेशन करने वाले एटम्स हैं जो लाइट दे रहे हैं, ठीक है ना, दे आर स्टिल पॉजिटिवली चार्ज. ओके, ठीक है, तो इसलिए पॉजिटिव प्लेट से ऊपर दूसरी तरफ डिफ्लेक्ट हो जाते. ओके, दैट कंफर्म्स दैट द फ्लेम इज अ प्लाज्मा. सो दैट इज व्हाट वी से दैट ऑन सन इट इज द फोर्थ स्टेट ऑफ मैटर, आयनाइज स्टेट ऑफ मैटर, जहां से लाइट आती है, एंड दैट लाइट कम्स ऑन मदर अर्थ. ओके, एंड दैट चेंजेस अवर लाइफ. नेक्स्ट, वेल दिस इज द प्रोसेस, एक्साइटेशन एंड एमिशन, ठीक है, दिस इज एमिशन फ्रॉम हायर स्टेट टू लोअर स्टेट एंड दिस इज एक्साइटेशन, ठीक है, दीज आर द बेसिक फंडामेंटल्स, सब जगह यही प्रोसेस है. ओके, कैन आई हैव द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड? इसी की वजह से वट एवर इज कमिंग फ्रॉम सन, कहीं पे वो रेडिएशन एब्सॉर्ब होते हैं और कहीं पे नहीं होते. फॉर एग्जाम्पल वाटर, वाटर और लैंड मास, इन दोनों में हीट कैपेसिटी अलग अलग है, ठीक है, तो जहां जहां समुद्र है वहां टेम्परेचर बढ़ता नहीं है, बट लैंड मास का टेम्परेचर बढ़ जाता है. फॉर एग्जाम्पल डेजर्ट, इट गेट्स हीटेड अप विद द सेम सनलाइट, राइट? सो व्हाट हैपेंस, यहां जो क्लाइमेट है या वायुमंडल है, ठीक है ना,